This is a list of sources that I used for this talk. So these are all available in New Zealand currently. I'm not going to spend much time on this. These numbers outside basically mean my evaluation as to what they're worth on a scale of 0 to 10 to anybody that wants to find out the future, I mean the history of astrology. As you can see, there's not really all that much. The best one, this one that got 8 out of 10, is available from the New Zealand Country Library Service. It was published in 1942. Alan McCaffrey's Astrology, History and Influence in the Western World. Very thorough book, very comprehensive, very in-depth, an excellent work. No, if you want that information, you'll have to jot it down or get it from me later. So that's a general history, this one here, and that's by far the best. The Origin of Zodiac obviously only deals with the Zodiac, and that goes for many of these books. They only deal with part of the history of astrology. They concentrate on part of it, and consequently they're less useful for that reason. Nonetheless, this is a superb book.
Not
offhand, no. These two are both available on interloan via the public library system. In other words, all you need is the title, the author, and the date. The publisher is often helpful, but you can actually get them without the publisher. Astrological Origins has been available in the shops for quite some time. It may not be currently, but that's it there. Pay for that. Sir Fagan's Sidereal Astrologer, as is Rupert Guido, but Fagan is more of a sidereal astrologer insofar as he's a bit prejudiced against tropical astrologers, so you do get a bit of that coming through. Nonetheless, he's the only astrologer that's actually got his act together and learned Egyptology and gone and deciphered the pictures in the Egyptian tombs. So he's a valuable source for that reason. Astrology and Roman law and politics. This guy, Kramer, is a professor. And this is an excellent book also, available from the National Library in Wellington. Like most pillars of the establishment, he's also unsympathetic to astrology, but nonetheless he's really gone into it deeply, and there's a lot of valuable information there. Same applies to Greek horoscopes. That's a standard reference on Greek horoscopes. Star of Bethlehem Mystery deals only with the Star of Bethlehem, but it's a brilliant book on that topic only, and anybody that wants to research the history of mundane astrology, that's essential. Astrology in the Third Reich is an exceptionally good book. It doesn't just deal with the astrology of Nazi Germany, it also deals with the whole of the 19th century in Europe and Britain. So it's a two-part book, and it's a very careful research exercise also. That's very, very valuable. The Sleepwalkers is a three-part biography, Kepler, Copernicus, and Galileo. Also very good. The Star-Crossed Renaissance, I've only briefly looked at that. That's also available from the National Library in Wellington, and you can obtain it on interloan. It appears to be just dealing with the Renaissance insofar as what I've been able to see it so far. The quotes I got, and all this material is of quotes,
none of it's hearsay, and so far as a lot of what people think about history and astrology is myth based on hearsay, and consequently research proves it invalid, and astrologers undermine their own credibility a lot by recycling these myths and not doing the necessary research to find out what actually went on in the past. I won't go through the rest, but basically as you get down here you get the more trite ones. Derek and Julia Parker's History of Astrology is available in the Auckland Public Library. It's alright, I mean, it's quite good. You can get some useful tidbits from it, but it's written for people in the 1980s. It's written for people that haven't got much time to get into the depth of the subject and just want a very light, superficial overview, and that's what you get. Yeah, it's only an introduction. Yeah. And it's also got a number of mistakes in it too. Down here there's a couple of books on the history of the calendar. Of course that's very much related to the history of astrology. So I wanted to look at the foundations. You know, what is in the chart, what are the main structural components, and where do they come from in history, and why? Obviously, Roger and Liz Green have covered the planets and the mythological origins of the planets very well, and I don't need to go into that. The only comments I'm going to make about that basically is to try and deal with the myth that these archetypes were consistent throughout history. It's a commonly held myth. I held it myself until I researched the history of astrology. So what we have around the outside is the frame of reference, the circular frame of reference. Represents the universe, but more specifically the solar system. And it's tied to a certain place and time on the face of the earth by means of the horizon and the vertical axis of the chart, or meridian, or whatever you want to call it, which orientates the event to the Earth's axis. And then there's the aspects that are the relationships between the various factors and indicate the point of unfolding of the various cycles that has been reached at that particular point in time. And then there's the houses, which are arbitrary subdivisions of the mundane circle, according to various theories that people have espoused over the past 2,000 years. So just off the top of my head, the horoscope itself seems to date from around about 500 BC. And there's a number of quotes here that deal with that. Mundane astrology predates that. But I don't have a specific time, but the horoscope of the individual arose out of mundane astrology.
What year is the horoscope?
Yeah, around about 500. The earliest horoscope is dated at 410 BC. That's Babylonian. Which is why you see in most books that the horoscope had a Babylonian origin. I would be cautious about that. I would say that it's more likely to have been a combination of Greek and Babylonian origin, because of considerable interchange amongst all the different civilizations and cultures at that point. This is from a talk I gave to the society meeting in Auckland a couple of weeks ago, which dealt with 65 famous astrologers. I only got through 17 of them. But there's the time scale there. These colours are the different cultures, approximately the period of time over which they managed to produce famous astrologers. Now, we have Egypt here, Babylon there, Persia there, Greece, Rome, the Byzantine Empire, this one's Arabia, that one's India, and that's the Druidic culture that covers both Britain and France. The point I want to make here is that quite a number of these originated before recorded history. So we have a number of independent origins. This one over here that hasn't been able to identify any famous astrologers is China. Of course, that likewise has an independent origin. But even in fairly locally linked areas, such as Persia and Babylon, which most people tend to think is the same culture, of course, they're quite different. And there was various travellers travelled amongst all those ones there in ancient times, and there was quite a bit of mixing going on. So you tend to get cliches saying that Greece produced such and such, and Babylon produced such and such, it's pretty misleading. I've got one or two skills. Okay. If I had a blackboard, I would, at this point, draw a big circle and put a dot in the middle. Oh, yeah, it's all right. Just try and visualise that, please. The horoscope represents this. The horoscope represents a certain event or person born in relationship to the rest of the universe. So the circle around the outside represents the universe. It is specifically brought into the just being the solar system, which is, of course, even more specifically, is the ecliptic, the zodiac, the Earth-Sun relationship cycle path. But the philosophy of holism appears to have originated before astrology itself. So astrology, no matter how ancient it is, grew out of the philosophy of holism, which basically saw each and every person, each and every thing as part of a whole, part of the whole universe. That's why you have a circle with a point in the middle. And, you know, maybe that's where the symbol for the sun came from, I don't know. Houses, and the excellent book there is Ralph Holden's The Elements of House Division, which does an overview of the whole thing. No other book has done the history of houses that I've been able to discover, and you only get the odd fleeting glimpse here and there in the general history books. But the houses seem to originate in Egypt in the 2nd century BC. The oldest surviving astrological text is not Ptolemy's text of Byblos, which you know, you'll commonly hear Ptolemy's text of Byblos quoted as the oldest surviving astrological text. It's the oldest textbook, not the oldest text. The oldest text was a poem written by Manilius, Marcus Manilius, a Roman about whom nothing much is known. But it's a very long poem, and it covers the whole of astrological theory and philosophy. And in that, which is in the time of Jesus Christ and Emperor Augustus, the houses already exist in the form that they're known now. But the systems of house division, of course, have had an evolution over the years. Ptolemy says that Ptolemy actually doesn't really distinguish, he is not to distinguish between the signs and the houses. And you find that the word house is actually used instead of the word sign. In the ancient writers from that time, there's a lot of confusion for that reason. And Ptolemy is not really representative of the ancient tradition for that reason. The Egyptian text, which has not survived from the 2nd century BC, which is the earliest source for the houses, from an Egyptian astrologer called Pitosiris, that apparently describes the houses in terms of what we know them now, but Ptolemy did not. And the people that have read Manilius' poem and commented on it, they say that Ptolemy did not say the same thing as he did either. So there's certain uncertainty there. And I think the main moral of that is that you don't take Ptolemy too seriously on the houses. But anyway, I'll just read a few quotes on the origin of the horoscope. An astrology then of the individual did not exist until ancient Greece. Early astrology was preoccupied with the welfare of the tribe, only later personified through the personal astrology for the monarch. In the British Museum alone, there are 4,000 astrological tablets which were catalogued by Professor Karl von Diesold, this is in the late 19th century, who was interested in astrology and wrote the relevant chapter in Franz Boll's book on the subject. Not one contains a horoscope. So 4,000 astrological tablets in the British Museum, we don't have one horoscope. Which tends to confirm the late origin of the horoscope. And these astrological tablets, what did they say if they didn't have horoscopes? Well, as I said before, it was mundane astrology. Right? They were recording the cycles of the planets through the signs and recording events that happened. I can't tell you much more than that. I would surmise that they had predictions as well. I think so.
If you think about it, it must have been a great conceptual
leap to be sure. And it all happened real fast in about 500 years. That's an interesting thing. The personal application of astrology came late in the course of civilization. Now this all the quote about the astrological tablets came from Eisler's book, The Royal Art of Astrology, which 1946. The astrology game by Malcolm Dean came out in the 1970s. That's an overview of contemporary astrology, but also has a chapter on history. And he says, the personal application of astrology came late in the course of civilization. In the beginning, the stars were watched solely for the welfare of the community. It is true that the life of the king was forecast early, because in primitive societies the good of the leader personified the good of the people. But neither the Babylonians, Chaldeans, nor Assyrians, or Persians ever thought to watch the stars for individual good. The old autocratic governments did not think an individual life of sufficient importance. Just as the Mayak represented a link between the divine powers that be and the world of the commoners, the astrology practiced for ancient monarchs may have provided the vehicle for Odysseus saying the same thing, basically. By Babylonian and Greek times, mathematics had developed to the point where planetary positions could be calculated with precision. The stylus and the sheet of papyrus had replaced the pyramids and stone hinges of more ancient astrologers. A portable astrology, as opposed to a monumental one, meant that an individual qualified to calculate a horoscope was no longer tied down to a ceremonial centre. One astrologer who has studied the problem of the origin of horoscopic astrology is, and he believes that there is circumstantial evidence to indicate it was in the reign of the Babylonian king Nebunnezar, which terminated around 539 BC as the personal horoscope underwent its own nativity. These were the last years of the Jewish captivity in Babylon, the time of the prophet Daniel. Babylonian mystery schools were active, and Zaratas the Chaldean, who taught the priesthood, counted amongst his pupils a young Greek named Pythagoras. Okay? So, and we all know from the Old Testament of the Bible that Daniel was made the chief of all the astrologers of Babylon. So, pretty clearly indicated around 500 BC we have Pythagoras being a student of the Chaldeans and Daniel being made chief of the astrologers of Babylon around about the same time. Another quote says, the earliest known personal horoscopes date from the 5th century BC and were calculated by Babylonian priests. There are 20 Babylonian cuneiform horoscopes known to exist in dates ranging from 410 BC to 69 BC. Now this is what has survived, right? This is what we've got to go on. 20 Babylonian horoscopes, 10 Egyptian horoscopes ranging from 38 BC to 93 AD, in other words very late. 200 Greek horoscopes are known. The dates for these range from 72 BC to 600 AD. All but 5 occur after Nort AD. So in other words, very few have survived from earlier times. And of course, Alexander the Great conquered the entire known world in 320 or 30 BC. So all the old civilizations were Hellenized then. And it seems fairly clear that whereas there's hard evidence of a Babylonian origin, certainly the conceptual development of astrology occurred after the Greek conquest. So the Greeks were responsible for it. Very few of these have a circular diagram. They're generally drawn in a square pattern, and the symbols for the planets do not appear to have been used for the planets and signs until the Middle Ages. And here's a Greek horoscope. This is one of the few circular ones. That's from the book Greek Horoscopes I was telling about before. Now, as you can see, this one dates from 1520 AD, in other words, while Jesus Christ was still alive. It has got axes. It has got a circle, very sloppily drawn. But it is obviously a holistic representation. And the axes of the chart are clearly being given significance. Over here we've got a quote from Manilius, which is the oldest surviving astrological text. A few interesting points here. Those of you that are at my talk last year will remember this, where he talks about the axis, first that the Earth is a sphere, which was known 500 years before Manilius. It was known in the earliest times of Greek civilization, around about 500-600 BC, that particular one, and I've got several quotes that verify that. And then they're talking about the Earth's axis and the fact that it's a line running through poles, and it's an imaginary line stretching through the air, going through the Earth's centre. And here Manilius criticises Chaldeans because they use equal houses, right? And of course, Many astrology books have been written in the 20th century saying that the equal house system is the oldest, and quoting Ptolemy as the authority to this. Now these people have written these books, all these credibility at this point, because firstly the Tetrabiblos wasn't the oldest text, and secondly the one that was the oldest text clearly disapproved of equal houses, equal house division. And he actually talks about this and says that they allow extra time and 2-hour divisions for the houses from the degree which the sun begins to run its daily course, which is the ascendant. 2 hours for each exciting sign they do. And in the horoscope is there at the end of the cycle, which of course is a reference to the fact that the word horoscope originally meant ascendant, not the whole chart. And that was the Greek term for the ascendant. And then he says that it's a false rule. By that myself. One would have thought they'd draw close to a perfect circle as they could, but maybe contemporary, certainly. It doesn't suggest that they're older, but it's certainly contemporary, yeah.
The interesting thing is, without a criticised equal house, didn't they want us to give any values themselves out of the point?
No, I haven't been able to find out exactly what house system. The comments that I've read in the British journal indicate that it was derived from the axis of the chart. In other words, certainly the vertical axis was featured heavily. This is just to illustrate the different cultures and where they came from. Egypt, Arabia down here, Babylon there, Assyria there, Persia there. Astrologers that came to the birth of Christ, the Magi, were represented on a church built in Constantine's time in Jerusalem as Persian, wearing Persian dress. But even in those days there was no consensus that they were Persian. There were competing traditions. One other tradition said they were Arabian. Modern books say they came from Babylon, but I've seen no ancient reference to that. Persia was the one given more weight in ancient times, not Babylon. In this area here, the northern Mesopotamian area, which is now Syria today, there was a culture that preceded Babylon called Akkad. And that's an interesting one, that's a very interesting one. That was between Sumeria and Babylonia in time. The Sumerians started around 6000 BC, 5000 BC, and they went through to about 3000 BC, and then the Akkadians started them. And the Akkadians went through to around about 1700 or 1800 BC, and that's when the first Babylon Empire arose. And the first Babylonian Empire lasted down to around 1200, 1300, I think. or maybe a bit longer, there were various invasions of different tribes at different times. Sometimes the empire survived them, sometimes they didn't. The Assyrians arose after 1000 BC or thereabouts, lasted a few hundred years, and then there was a second Babylonian empire, brief, only a couple of hundred years, and that's the one that's mentioned in the Old Testament of the Bible, the second one, not the first one. The Ethiopians featured prominently. The Ethiopians actually conquered Egypt at some point. I haven't got the date for that, but there's a reference in here somewhere that says that when the Ethiopians conquered Egypt, some of the Egyptians fled north to Babylon, where they taught the Babylonians astrology. Right, so they use that, and that quote has come from either a Greek or a Roman historian. Well, the Ethiopians had their own culture and own tradition. Akkad. Yeah, A-double-C-A-D, and sometimes spelled A-double-K-A-D. There were two traditions. By far the most influential was the 12-house system. There was an 8-house system. That was definitely used in Egypt. Where else? I'm not sure. I haven't seen the evidence it's used anywhere else. But you have to be very careful, because as I said, the word houses meant different things to different people at different times. And it's very easy to jump to the wrong conclusion. I have another quote here that just finishes off the origin of the horoscope. It says, early horoscopes do not always mark the meridian and the ascendant. Sometimes sign position only is given, and little or no interpretation is attached. Now, as far as the ascendant is concerned, in ancient times, quote, one was considered born under those planets and fixed stars across the eastern horizon at the precise moment of one's birth. The degree of the ecliptic at this particular moment constituted one's horoscope, also known as the Hora or Ascendant. That's a quote from Astrological Origins. Dr. Richard Garnett, who was curator of printed books at the British Museum, London, was one of the great Greek scholars of his day. A paper he published in the Classical Review in 1899 quotes various Greek writers to the effect that Hora not only meant hour, but also meant the degree of the zodiac rising at the time of the nativity. He also wrote astrological books under the name of A.T. Trent. Another quote says, it's interesting that no Babylonian horoscope mentions the ascendant or any other secondary astrological indicator. In other words, they only had planets and signs. I'm not going to be able to pin down the time, but it's pretty much concurrent with that.
If horoscope means ascendant, then surely if they're using the term horoscope, that's in the
what it means. Oh, yeah, sure. There is a quote in here somewhere that I vaguely recall that it's got your first to Egypt, something that's surviving, picture in one of the tombs, has got the horizon marked, and that dates around 1000 BC, if I recall. We may come to it if I get time. But,
So there's two tombs emerging. Where is the the horoscope does refer to as being an ascendant or an
ascendant. Just basically that the horizon was the first thing given significance apart from the planets and the signs, right? That was the first, that was where they went to local space, local time. Because the planets and the signs fed the whole culture, right? The predictions made from that were for everybody. So that's why I said the origin of mundane astrology. But when they started honing in on the degree rising, that fixed it to a certain time and place, which is where the horoscope came out of. Now, there's another quote here from Origin of the Zodiac that says, "A bird, when it emerges from its shell, adopts as its parent the first living creature that it sees, and this impression is ineffaceable, as Conrad Lorenz and others have demonstrated." I mention that simply because it tends to support the fact that the ascendant is very important biologically. Right? I mean, why? Why does the first thing the bird sees have that impression? The moment of birth, you know? Obviously it's very important. And the automatic deduction is the same for human beings. No double aim in horoscope mentions the ascendant or any other factor. Alright, that says the same thing but from a different book. Or any other factor than planets and signs. This supports the fact that, you know, the horoscope as we know it came from Greece rather than Babylon. Well, Babylon invented the horoscope, but, you know, what's a horoscope without an ascendant or any axes or anything like that, or any houses? You know? Maybe you can't call that a horoscope. Hence it seems that today's astrology was invented by the Greeks after they acquired Babylonian ideas. By 400 BC they were using Babylonian sign names for the months of the solar calendar. Especially after they conquered Babylon in 331 BC, it was the Greeks who first attached significance to the ascending sign, which is the one rising on the horizon at the moment of birth. Thus the word horoscope comes from the Greek horoscopus, which literally means I watch that which is rising. That quotes from Astrology, Science of Superstition by the Professor of Psychiatry at London University, Hans Olsen. Moving on to the houses, we're only going to 10:30, might be able to bite, since I've spent time on the houses, we'll bypass those. But there's quite a lot there that proves that the houses were also used for exaltations. In other words, exaltations and houses were, although they seem quite different things to us now, apparently they have a common origin, and there's a number of quotes there that verify that. In other words, certain of these ancient cultures actually used the word houses to refer to the signs that the planets were exalted in. Yeah, right, it's where they belong. So they'd use the accounts here. Yeah. And the exaltations, just in passing, appear to originate around about 786 BC, I think it is. Nobody's been able to find the event, but there's a certain moment of time. The exaltations actually derive from a certain moment in time. And the exaltations, of course, are derived from specific degrees within the sign originally, not the sign itself, which is why you get the specific moment in time. And which culture was that? That was Assyria. Assyria. That's the exaltation. The best guess that anyone has made so far, as far as I can see, is that when the Assyrians conquered Egypt, in that century, they came across the horoscope of eternity, which had such an impression on them that they went home and copied it. And they picked some date, which was very important in their own tradition,
And they look back in their records because the Assyrians did have tablets of records like the Babylonians did. And they looked up the country positions, and those were the positions that became exaltations. Okay, moving on to the zodiac. The Aquarian age will occur when the vernal equinox processes back into the constellation of Aquarius. You all know that. Most astrologers believe that the boundaries of the constellations are unknown. Thus they believe that the beginnings of the astrological ages cannot be accurately ascertained. The celestial globes for the Middle Ages show constellations of varying sizes, but these visual motifs that symbolise the constellations were arbitrarily fitted to the star groups. In ancient times, the zodiac was divided into 12 equal divisions, because it was derived from the lunar calendar, in which the year contained 12 complete lunations, 12 full moons. Zodiac, therefore, like the lunar mansions and the decans, which are the astrological systems that predated the zodiac, originated as a time measuring device. That's very important, that, and runs completely contradictory to the commonly accepted beliefs of astrologers. Nonetheless, this is not a quote, this is what I've written for myself, simply to summarise. I've got so much stuff here that he'll be here the rest of the day, just on the zodiac itself. The idea of dividing circles into 360 degrees originated independently in Babylon, Egypt and China as an approximation to the length of the year. The primary origin of the sign symbols was cultural. The signs represented what the month was notable for. For instance, the full moon in the sign of the Virgin tells the Babylonians that the young corn plant would soon be sprouting fresh and virginal in the furrows, according to Guido. When eventually precession detached the seasons from the constellations, this original practical calendar usage became lost, and zodiac became more a mythological and religious frame of reference, with the inevitable degeneration into superstition, eventually. A parapigmata found at Miletus in Greece dates to 400 BC, providing hard evidence of the use of the zodiac as a calendar even at that late date. A parapigmata is a piece of stone that has holes drilled in it, and wooden pegs were used to signify the date. And the months were illustrated with the sign of the zodiac. The academic establishment appears to have settled on Babylon circa 600 BC as being the time and place where the zodiac took its present form. In other words, only 100 years or so before the horoscope was invented. I think, and Culver and Iona's book, The Gemini Syndrome, although it is not clear on what evidence this is based, the fact that neither Homer nor Hesiod mentioned it makes it unlikely the zodiac was known in Greece before Cleostratus or Tanitus in about 500 BC, according to Richard Hintley Allen, and his book is called Star Names, and it was published in 1899. It's a very good book on the origin of the constellations, right? And he deals with constellations and nothing else. So, Homer, of course, dates from 1000 BC. Hesiod was around about 750 BC, and neither of these writers, whose writings have survived, neither of those two people mention the zodiac, which provides fairly good evidence that it wasn't known in Greece in their time. Also about 500 BC, Herodotus wrote that the Egyptians were the first of all mankind to invent the year and divide it into 12 parts. Herodotus travelled, he certainly travelled to Egypt. He may have travelled to the other civilization centres at the time. There's a an interesting story. I didn't get the quote for it because it's one of those things that you see and you think, oh, it's not immediately relevant, and then later you regret not writing it down. But what this quote said, that he was being shown around an Egyptian temple, one of the main Egyptian temples, and they took him down to this room underground, large room, and there were rows and rows of statues, 345 of them in long lines, and the Egyptian that was showing around took him up the first one and said, this is the high priest, this is the man who was the high priest before our present high priest, and took him to the next one and said, this was the high priest before that, right? And took him right down, 345, and there was a consecutive line, unbroken tradition, 345 high priests. And it's known that Egyptian civilization, the recorded history of it, dates from about 3000 BC. That was the beginning of the first empire, Egyptian empire. Although there was civilization in the Egyptian valley for another 3 millennia before that. The civilization itself arose then. So the 345 high priests appeared to be that priest out there. Well, Herodotus is 500 BC, so that's 2.5 million.
We call the fixed sign these days, because they weren't fixed then. the southern fish, the Fromont boat, which is the Arabian name for the bright star, has obviously moved out of Pixar and Aquarius and has been reallocated to the constellation of the southern fish. But Antares is still in Scorpio, and Aldebaran is still in Taurus, and Regulus is still in Leo. The other three are the three of the brightest stars in the sky, and they've always been significant in all cultures. The Babylonian boundary stones recorded land sales. They show a young crescent moon with its horns straight up, adjacent to two stars. The young moon can only have its position near the spring equinox, and no two stars have been adjacent to the equinox since the age of Gemini. Since the kings referred to by the stones dated at as late as 1200 BC is the time Moses, so we're talking about relatively modern times, the picture on the stones was obviously a traditional motif that had survived since the start of civilization, when the year began at the new moon conjunct the vernal equinox conjunct the two bright stars of Gemini. So here we have an evidence of an even older tradition, the tradition of the observance of the new moon conjunct the vernal equinox and beginning the year then, dating right back to the age of Gemini, which the age of Taurus started at about 4,152 BC, so you're going back beyond that. So the zodiac itself in its final form may well have only coalesced around about 600 BC, but the structural components of the zodiac are extremely ancient. Cyril Fagan says that the Greeks were sole inventors of the tropical zodiac, and they had many versions of it. We're moving on to a different topic than the tropical zodiac. And at the time of Alexander the Great, when Greek learning invaded the ancient civilizations of Egypt, Persia, Mesopotamia, and India, the two most popular zodiacs had the vernal points in Aries 10 and Aries 8. The one measured from Aries 10 originated from the cuneiform tablets of the Babylonian astronomer Nabu-Rhenu in 500 BC. It's known to scholars as System A, and the zodiac measured from 8 Aries is known as System B. System B was derived from the tablets of the Babylonian astronomer Kadenu around about 380 BC. Professors Neugebauer and Van Poesten in their book Greek Horoscopes say that the normal System B is frequently found in astrological writing far into the Middle Ages. I don't know, someone may correct me here, that's the time pre-Renaissance, around about, 1000 BC, 1300? In other words, System B, which was originated 386 BC, which is also called the Hellenistic Zodiac, was not only the one mostly used in Greece, and it was measured from 8 Aries, the equinox and 8 Aries, the general equinox and 8 Aries, but they used it long after it became redundant. They used to write in into right up around, they used it for 1,000 years after it became redundant. It's pretty hard to take astrologers seriously when they do this sort of thing, isn't it? And it also puts paid to the myth that the tropical zodiac was the only one used in Greek times, or in the Middle Ages. They also say that of 180 Greek horoscopes that have survived, only 7 are comparable to modern systems, which just goes to show the fact that the tropical zodiac had very little existence in Greek times, in Greek and Roman times. Two earlier Greek zodiacs were measured from Aries 15 and Aries 12. Fagan says the tropical zodiacs are those which are measured from a tropical point, from the solstices and equinoxes. He also says that the Greeks considered all 5 of their tropical zodiacs to be fixed. So in other words, you have to look at how you define the tropical zodiac, and it's defined these days as a moving zodiac, right? Whereas these other ones that these people call tropical zodiacs were considered to be fixed. Obviously, one of the questions is whether they were tropical zodiacs or not, or how are you going to define it? The fifth one, in other words, the one that arose from Area Zero, was our tropical zodiac, invented by Hipparchus about 139 BC with the Caduceal and Zero. The fact that Ptolemy was one of the few people to accept the logic of Hipparchus is proven by Rupert Liddell, who quotes from five separate surviving sources from the time of the Roman Empire to prove that the sign Aries was not generally considered to begin from the vernal equinox. For instance, the Michigan Astrological Papyrus number 1, which dates from the 2nd century AD, says, quote, the marking points of the sun are four, two equinoctial in the 8 degrees of Aries and Libra, the summer tropic in the 8 degrees of Cancer, and the winter tropic in the 8 degrees of Capricorn. Manelius says that 1 degree in tropical signs is to be distinguished, it moves the world and alters the seasons, some places power in the 8 degrees, others prefer the 10th, and there's even been a writer who's lost to the 1st degree, the alteration and shortening of the days. In other words, Hipparchus is regarded as a bit radical. Guido credits Cyril Fagan as being the first to discover that the original zodiac was sidereal in 1947. Evidence that the astrological ages were recognized in ancient times comes to us from the words of Jesus Christ, as quoted in the original Greek New Testament. The phrase there is Suntalaeus tu Aeonius. If I had a blackboard, I could write that down for you. But this is the expression that was rendered in the King James Version as the end of the world. The Reverend Jacobs, who wrote this book here, which is the best book if you want to get into the subject of astrology in the Bible, Astrology here in Church, he says that in the original Greek, this phrase meant the close of the age. Aeon meaning age. And that Christ was referring to the end of the age of Aries, not the end of the world. Okay? And that's just one example of the many mistakes that were made by the people that made the King James Version of the Bible. Astrology Pew and Church has never been available in New Zealand. You have to get it mail order from the States. Reverend Don J. Jacobs, the author, was a Methodist minister he did postgraduate studies in the life of Jesus. He got his inspiration from Albert Schweitzer, who did very much the same thing. Albert Schweitzer wrote a book called The Historical Life of Jesus or something like that. Reverend Jacobs studied under the chap who is a professor who edited Schweitzer's book. So he continued the tradition. He practiced as a minister for something like 15 years. But he specialised so much and so interested in the historical story of Jesus that it was a passion for him and a hobby. Eventually he realised he had to learn astrology, so he did. Once he learned astrology, he got so into it, he became an astrologer. That's why on this book you see in quotes the words Moby Dick. Moby Dick was the name that he used as an astrologer, and he was living in Hawaii at the time in the 1970s, and at the time of the counterculture where it was very trendy to adopt funny names. So, What you have there from that little story, and you know, it'll take too much time to actually go through all the quotes to verify that, but clearly you can identify the exact transitions of the ages once you know the speed at which the two zodiacs are moving relative to each other, the borders of the signs, and the origin of each zodiac, the zero point of each zodiac. Once you know that, then you can define exactly when the transition of the age is. Now that information has been available to astrologers for at least 30 years now, so clearly quite a severe reflection on astrologers' ability to deal with their own past, their own real traditions, and to cling stubbornly to incorrect myths. It really severely undermines astrologers' credibility, and yet astrologers worldwide seem to have this affliction. And I personally think it's time that they got over it. It's no good saying that you don't know when the Aquarian age is going to start, because nobody agrees on the borders of the sidereal zodiac, but those borders have actually been established by historical research. You can debate whether the logic that was used in the research is correct or not. Anybody's free to do that, but to go on ignoring the fact that the research has been done, it really is not on. Yeah, around about 2,300 or something. So the age of Pisces started around about 220 AD. Yeah. Of course, you know, we're all free to say that the historical ages have very approximate borders anyway, in terms of what actually happens in real life. The point I'm trying to make is that you can't go away with get around with saying that the borders are not, you know, I mean the transition's not known. The dating can't be done. The dating can be done. Mm. Now, we want to get on to the fact that Taurus in the original sidereal zodiac was the first sign of the zodiac. Now, it's very important to deal with this while we're running out of time. There was a program on television a few months back by David Attenborough called The First Eden, and in episode 2 he did the whole episode on the fact that all the ancient cultures were dominated by the bull symbol. The history and culture of the Taurian age is dominated by the bull symbol, and this is a quote from Astrological Origins, and most civilized societies of the period, culminating in Mithraism that rivaled Christianity for several centuries. And another quote here, when the mountain tribes that occupied the Mesopotamian plains, they brought with them the idea that the universe is shaped just like a mountain, only more perfectly made so that the corners point to the equinoxes. Accordingly, they began erecting ziggurats, which are set pyramids, with corners set to the cardinal points. To make them like real mountains, they planted gardens on them and installed irrigation. The Hanging Gardens of Babylon became one of the seven wonders of the world. The ziggurat at Bar-Sitki was built in seven levels, each representing a planet, and painted in the corresponding colour. And on top was an altar which bore the horns of the equinoctial bull. Most writers agree that the first configuration formed to act as the sun mansion was that of Taurus the bull, and it marked the vernal equinox from 4000 to 1700 BC. That's one quote. Another quote says, the zodiac was known to the Akkadians as the furrow of heaven, ploughed by the heavenly directing bull. That was the phrase used, directing bull. Our Taurus, which comes about 3880 to 1730 BC, was first in 12. Jacob's 12 sons became the tribes of the 12 tribes of Israel. The 12 Hebrew tribes were traditionally correlated with the sign of the zodiac. See Genesis 49:1-28. Reuben, representing Taurus, was mentioned first, just as the constellation Taurus pulled the zodiac around the sky before 2000 BC during the age of Taurus. Yeah, that's why they had the book. This is a horoscope from AD 177, very late, an Egyptian horoscope. Just have a look at these here. Here's the zodiac. This is a tradition that had long become redundant, right? 81.77, vernal equinox has almost gone into Pisces. Okay, Taurus the bull leads the zodiac. Here we have Taurus, Gemini, Cancer, Leo. Notice the way that the animals are pointing, clearly showing this is the front. Virgo, there's the earth corn. Libra, Scorpio, Sagittarius, Capricorn, Aquarius, Pisces, Aries. Notice that the ram is looking that away. Right? Capricorn is facing that away. Sagittarius is facing that away, as is the scorpion. They're all facing that away. The zodiac ends there, starts there. Okay? That's
not the only one I've got. There's another one.
This is the zodiac of Venera, which is somewhat earlier, but it's also it's not so easy to see. But here you have the ram. See his head pointing backwards. This is very common in ancient zodiacs to have the ram with the head pointing backwards, or the ram is actually lying down, reclining. Here we have the charging bull. This transparency has not worked very well, but one hoof is angled down, the head's down, the horn's pointing forward, and the other front leg is up. You know how the bull brings his leg up and he's about to charge? He's pawing the ground, right? The charging bull, the symbol of the start of the zodiac. Yeah, well, I suppose so. Yeah. Haven't really gone into the legs. I can circulate a better copy of that. Also, in the Roman zodiac, that's attached to this photocopy, you have the bull charging and the ram with his head turned around, looking backwards. But you can clearly see the So this is a redundant tradition that is still being retained 2,000 years almost after it's ceased to be effective, ceased to be real. It just goes to illustrate the power of tradition in astrological thought. Well, the thing is, in modern zodiac, the pictures that people do of Aries, the ram's charging, right? This is the point I'm trying to make. You know? Because they think, oh, it's the start of the zodiac, your day has a lot of energy and drive. You know? But it's not real. It's not the real tradition. It might be real for people these days, but it doesn't actually represent the tradition of the zodiac. Yeah. Right. No, originally the ram didn't have that energy. Certainly if you use a tropical zodiac, you want the ram to have a lot of energy, yeah. I agree, but
not even from that point of view, I'm just looking at why the ram has changed its position. The age of Aries took over.
Yeah,
so therefore that's why
yeah.
all the stone statues of the ram and all that sort of stuff taken over from the world.
Yeah, right. Yeah, but we've adopted the moving zodiac now, see? We don't use... This is one other thing. You know, I was going to get you all to say, do you believe in the age of Aquarius? Raise your hands.
Yeah. Believe in
the age of Aquarius? This is... A lot of astrologers say they believe in the age of Aquarius is coming, right? This is something that you often get, particularly in the astrological media, you know, as you saw in the video last night, that people dancing and singing the age of Aquarius, right? The thing is, a tropical astrologer who only supposedly believes in one zodiac also believes in the age of Aquarius. He directly contradicting himself, because the age of Aquarius only exists if you believe in a concurrent movement of two zodiacs, right? The vernal equinox is moving through a cycle. sign on the side of your zodiac, right? It's moving back into sidereal Aquarius. That's where the Aquarian age is coming from. It's coming from the sidereal sign, the constellation.
It's okay to believe that.
Yeah, that's okay, as long as you're honest about it, right? I think people just need to work it out in their own head, what the situation is, and a little more clearly, because you get a lot of mistakes made in this area. Now, the Persians also worshipped the bull. They designated successive signs of the zodiac by the letters of the alphabet, and with them, A stands for Taurus, the bull. B for Gemini, the twins, etc., clearly indicating they considered Taurus the first sign of the zodiac. Reference to the astrological books of the Jews shows that they too considered Taurus the leader of the zodiacal signs. In fact, in all the ancient zodiacs that have come down to us, Taurus apparently began in the year. That's one thing. Another one, from a different book, says, in early Hebrew, Taurus was designated by the first letter of the Hebrew alphabet, Aleph, which translated actually means ox. And bull. Another quote says, from a different book, says, in all ancient zodiacs that have been preserved, it is found that the year commenced in the constellation of the bull. And a quote from yet another book says, in all ancient zodiacs preserved, the Taurus began the year. And Virgil, the Roman poet, has a lion in one of his poems that says, with golden horns bright, Taurus opes the year, opes as an open. And the funny thing is, even among the Romans of the Aries Age, 1955 BC to 221 AD, when the vernal point was gliding backwards through that constellation, Taurus was still hailed as Princeps Armenti, or the leader of the zodiacal hill. Okay, just to finish up, obviously there's a lot that I haven't got through today, but it always seems to be okay. The sidereal zodiac was measured from two bright stars, Aldebaran in the exact centre of Taurus. And this is with the origin of the phrase bullseye in common idiom. Bullseye means the exact mathematical center. And that originated from the ancient Egyptians and their sidereal zodiac, where Aldebaran, the bullseye, was the star right in the middle of constellation Taurus. And the sidereal zodiac was actually measured from that. In other words, you go that 15 degrees from Aldebaran, you come to the Pleiades. Pleiades was the first asterism in the lunar mansions in ancient times. That was the start of the zodiac. So clearly, there's no doubt whatsoever that that is how the sidereal zodiac was measured, and it just so happens there was an exact opposition between Aldebaran and the star, the Scorpion Antares, right in the middle, exactly 15 degrees of Scorpio on the opposite side. 2 minutes of arc is how exact they are. It's the exact opposition, but only 2 minutes of arc difference. That was so impressive to the ancient Egyptians that that's how